fellowship, you will come here and testify that it is my turn indeed.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. You will tell someone that it is your turn.
It is my turn.
It is your turn.
It is my turn.
To testify, to the Lord. Because we serve the living God. He is the same yesterday. He is the same today. And he will be the same forever. If God says yes, no one can say no. If God opens the door, no one can cross it. Because he has all the power. Oh, because he has all the power. Oh, hallelujah.
Father, we thank you this morning.
We worship you, we exhort you. Father, we have gathered once again, Father, in your presence. Lord, bless us through your word. Father, if you don't bless us, we are not living here today. Father, if you don't change our lives, we are not living here today. Lord, let your word transform us. Let your word nourish our heart. Let your word destroy every evil waters in our families. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, let your spirit come and talk to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Amen. Put your hands together for the name of the Lord. Power and might belongs to our God. Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
We are speaking on the team that I started last week. Building an altar to the Lord through your offering. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Building an altar to the Lord through your offering. And I said something that when we talk about altar, it is the meeting place between heaven, that is God, and earth, that is man. When God creates something we call covenant, and where human being or man offers sacrifice, that is altar. So meeting place between God and mankind. Where God creates covenant, and where mankind offers sacrifice, that is altar. Hallelujah. Oh, amen.
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 And I said something that the covenant of God is yes and amen. He is faithful that he will never lie. He will never fail in his part of the covenant agreement. So the Bible says in the book of Psalms 89 verse 34, that my covenant I will not break, nor utter the words that have gone out of my lips. So God is faithful that he will never fail his part of the covenant agreement. And I said, when we talk about the covenant of God, it is something that we say it is legally binding. Legally binding. Meaning it is conditional. You need to, you know, perform your part in order for God to also perform his part. So I said, God will fail is part of the covenant agreement. So if we Christians perform our part, then definitely God will also perform his part. Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
And we talk about two types of, you know, altars. I said we have evil altars and we have godly altars. But actually we started with the evil altars. And we are continuing, hallelujah, this morning. And I know you will be blessed. Oh, hallelujah. So I said, when we talk about if waters, we are talking about a place where evil spirit gather in order to devise schemes against people. Hallelujah. I'm just, you know, summarizing if waters, the definition. A place whereby evil spirits gather in order to plan evil against people. So that is the place whereby they sacrifice all sort of things. So any place that a goat, a sheep, a cow is slaughtered in order to perform a ritual is called an altar. Hallelujah. Any place whereby a sheep, could be a cow, a goat, or an animal is slaughtered to perform a ritual is called an altar. And I said we have evil altars. So before even the devil can do something in your life, he needs to perform what we call sacrifices at where we call an altar life. Hallelujah. So that is where they perform all kind of, you know, divination, this kind of incantation, sorcery, and all other things. So before even they can destroy your family, before they can destroy your business, before they can even buy sickness, disease for you, they need to sacrifice something unto God for them to succeed. So an altar is a place that Christians don't joke with when it comes to altar life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
This man, God will bless you.
Yeah.
So I said, many of us are suffering as a result of, you know, evil waters in our families. Evil waters in our family. Some are fighting against our marriage life. It doesn't matter. The person that you married, if the person could be an angel, the person could be an angel. If you have evil order in your family fighting against your marriage, even when you marry an angel, the marriage will break. You can perform your part of the marriage responsibility diligently, but because of an evil order in your family, there is no way the marriage can succeed. We have evil orders fighting against our finances. So you will see two people doing the same work. One can build a nice factory, nice house, buy a posh car, and the other person will always work. Hallelujah. The person will take the salary and will not know even what to do with the money. At the end of the day, the person will be, you know, borrowing. And I don't know. I take this salary, but I don't know what I will do. And the money will not finish. It is an evil water fighting against your finances. Some are diseases and sicknesses. No matter the kind of exercise that you do, still you will be what? You will be sick. No matter the kind of food that you eat, still you will be what? Sick. Because they are saying exercise gives what? Strength. But somebody is a player, football player, who has been exercising daily, but still the person has been attacked. Heart attack. Last 3 days, I heard this about as a Nigerian player. They were training and he had heart attack. How can you have heart attack when you are, you know, training? It is because of an evil order operating in that family. Hallelujah. But this morning, at the end of the sermon, you will break every evil order in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. If you believe, shout amen.
Amen.
You must be served the living God. The Bible says power and might belong to our God. Oh, hallelujah. Let's read Numbers chapter 22. Something in Numbers chapter 23. Numbers 22 is a biblical example about evil waters that somebody erected against the children of God. Listen to me. There is this man called Bala, who is a prophet. And Bala, who is a king in Moab. And Bala wanted to, you know, destroy the people of Israel. They were the children of God. And Bala knew that in order for you to succeed in destroying these Israelites, you need to do something that we call an altar. You need to build an altar. Because when you are fighting for something, when you are fighting against somebody, and you decide to build an altar, there is no way you will be defeated. That's the secret in life. If you want to be victorious in whatever you do, build an altar, offer a sacrifice, and there is no way you will be defeated in life. I can use my life as a testimony. My father's life as a testimony. He built an altar. And when he finished, the Lord spoke that it is done. No matter what men will do, it is what? Done. You cannot build an altar and fail in life. You cannot build an altar and what? Fail in life. So, but like, an altar, then there is no way you will fail in the sight of the Israelites. So Bible said he went to a prophet called Bala. Then please do this thing for me. Let's read Numbers 22 verse 6. Numbers 22 verse 6. Numbers 22 verse 6. Numbers 22 verse 6. Listen to what Balak said. Verse 6, yes.
Numbers chapter 22 verse 6.
Yes.
Therefore, please come at once.
Therefore, please come at once.
Curse these people for me.
Curse these people for me.
For they are too mighty for me.
For they are too mighty for me.
Perhaps I shall be able to defeat them.
Perhaps I shall be able to defeat them.
And drive them out of
the land. And drive them out of the land.
For I know that.
For I know.
He whom you bless.
He whom you bless
is blessed.
Is blessed.
And he
unless you curse them for me. Read Numbers chapter 23, verse 1 for me. 23, verse 1.
Numbers chapter 23,
verse 1. Yes.
Therefore, Balaam
said, and Balaam said, before I can curse them, yes,
build seven altars
for me. Build seven altars for me.
And prepare for me here seven bulls and seven.
And prepare for me seven rams and seven bulls on each altar. Please stand there for me. So, Balaam told Balaam that before I can curse these people that you are referring to as mighty, you need to build an altar for me. Hallelujah. Beloved, what I want you to know is that somebody has erected an evil altar against your family, against your life. That is why you are passing through all these sufferings, all these inappropriate challenges. That is why life is not moving on as you are expecting. You are doing your best. You are doing your best. But still, you are struggling because of an evil altar that has been erected against you. Balaam said, then before I can curse them, then you need to build an altar, seven altars, and the seven altars you need to sacrifice one bull and one what ram on each altar before I can curse these people for you. Hallelujah. Continue for me.
Verse 2. And Balak did just as Balaam had.
And Balak, the king of Moab, did as the prophet instructed him.
And Balak and Balaam offered a bull and a ram.
And they did whatever that the prophet asked them to do. And for me. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, are you here with me?
Yes.
Oh, are you here with me?
Yes.
I said that before you can defeat somebody, this is the secret of life. You need to build an altar. If all these politicians, before they win an election, they build what we call an altar, secret altar. Most of these rich men, when you go to the apartment, they have a secret room that nobody enters apart from those that they are in the same group with. And that place, that room, is what we call altar. That's what they do all sort of what things. When you go to Ghana, those people that sell at Central Market, that is what most people do. They have this altar that they will use for chanting, no matter who you are, you will stand there by. Even if you are not prepared, hallelujah. You cannot pass by their store and decide not to buy anything because they have this kind of evil waters there. So the moment you pass, if you have not planned, you just enter, oh please, I'm buying this. You buy it, you go home, and you realize that you want something that you didn't like. Hallelujah. And if you sell it back, they will tell you that honey and chocolate and some farm, but you don't buy it and bring it to back. Here's not like UK. Whereby you can buy something 30 good days. And you want, you will return it. And they will accept it. Somebody will buy a nice suit like mine, and the person will just wear it for maybe 10 days. The person will put the sticks and the sticker and everything inside and return it. Hallelujah. Put your hands together for the name of the Lord. So people are choosing evil orders to, you know, succeed in life, to get riches in life. Most riches are not, you know, something from God. Even musicians, these musicians, some are putting orders just to, you know, spread their songs, broadcast their song, get fame. Even these kind of actors and whatever you call them, these musicians that now they call them, they themselves ministers. I don't know where they call that name from. Minister and a mission. They are all using all sorts of, you know, ways just to get fame. Some are using orders, evil orders. Even most pastors are using evil orders. They build altars in their secret room. And they will get a lot of people in their, you know, church. They are not saying anything, but people will go there. I was watching this kind of, you know, pastor, and he was performing something. I said, looking at the people in the church, I was even wondering why. in the church for 10 years. They have not got even a single miracle, but still they go there. Because of an if order that they are using. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you don't know life, if you don't know spiritual things, you think the word is just like, you know, normal, 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 like the way you see it. We are living in a spirit world. I classify this word as a spiritual world. It's not a physical world. Everything that, you know, happens, happens in the world, in the spiritual realm, before it will manifest in the physical realm. The people that you are seeing, your leaders that you are seeing, if God is to open your eyes for them to, for you to see what they have been doing in a secret, I don't tell you. Even like some of them, now the God opened my eyes and I saw something. I said, wow, he was revealing unto me the leaders of this world, what they have been doing. They have this big, you know, a building, nice building, and they perform all their rituals just to get, you know, the sympathy of the people. That is what is going on in this world. So Paul said, for the weapons of our warfare are not what?
Hallelujah.
So there was no way that somebody can curse the people of God. Because God entered into a covenant that whoever will bless you, I will bless them. And whoever will curse you, I will curse them. But the Lord swore by himself the other day. So I said, before a covenant can have an impact, there must be something that we call an oath. It must be sealed with something. And God said, because there is no one greater than me, I swear by myself that I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. So when Balaam inquired, the Lord said, there is no way you can curse these people, because they are blessed beyond curse. Oh, hallelujah. And there is no way you can denounce them. So the Bible said he went back and told Balaam that, do not something, these people cannot be cursed. And Balaam said, you know, I've rendered something, that when you went to the mountain top, I saw some of these people that you were cursing, they were rendered, you were rendered what? Being what? Blessed bountifully. So I thought you were, you know, blessing them on the mountain. He said, no, I wasn't blessing them. But because the Bible says, whoever will bless them, I will bless them. And whoever will curse them, I will curse them. So when I went to the mountainside, I was trying to, you know, curse them. But what I realized was that the cursing was turning into blessing. The cursing was turning into blessing. Oh, hallelujah. That was what God made the people of Israel. Because Abraham erected a quoting altar. So what quoting altar does is to, you know, change the plans of an evil altar. So if it is cursed, quoting altar will change it to blessing. So if they brought something like sickness for you, because you have built a quoting altar, the sickness will turn into good health. Oh, hallelujah. If they brought something like poverty for you, because you have built a quoting altar, the poverty will turn into riches. So whatever they will plan, because of the quoting altar, it will change for your good.
Fulfill it. He will make it happening in the mighty name of
that have noticed that he has still been blessed bountifully. So please don't bless them. And Balaam said, I'm not blessing them. But these people, when you curse them, the curse will turn to blessing. Hallelujah. So I am not what cursing them. Very soon, whoever will pronounce a curse on you, it shall turn into blessing. It shall turn into blessing. Whoever will devise a disease and sickness for you, it will turn into a good health. Whoever will unblock death for you, it will give you longer life in the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. If you believe it, shout and believe it, amen. And make a joyful noise unto the name of the living God. Oh, hallelujah! Oh, hallelujah! We serve the living God. We serve the living God. There is something that we use to change the plot of the enemy. And that's quoting water. We'll talk about it next week. Quoting water. There is something that we used to change the plans of the enemy. So, as they are planning, you will be there and you will be eating. Hallelujah. And you will be enjoying your music. And whatever they will plan will turn back to them. Will turn back to them. So, that is why you know the story of Haman and Mordecai. When Haman came to his house, he told his wife, Sarah, that you know what happened? I wanted to kill, you know, these Israelites. I wanted to destroy them. But I'm seeing something that maybe it will be difficult for me. And the wife said, it will be difficult for you, but you will surely fail. Because these people that you have started to plan evil against, if they are really the Jews, if they are really the children of God, then surely you will fail in their sight. Because there is no way you can, you know, curse the people of God. You are a child of God. There is no way somebody can succeed in cursing you. There is no way somebody can succeed in killing you. Was run out, buried in that what? Pit. Because they were the children of God. And there's no way you can succeed in kissing them. And you know, Balak is too stubborn. This Balak man. And he told Balak that I'll beat seven waters again. And I'll offer a ram and a bull on each of the waters. So this is the third time. That is the way the enemy operated. The enemy never get tired. That is how the enemy operates. He never got get what tired. So he pumped seven waters for the third time. And this time, Adam said, let me tell you something. Whatever you are doing now, the Lord said, I should tell you that very soon, Numbers 24 verse 18. Numbers 24 verse 18. But he said, whatever you are doing for the third time, the Lord said, very soon, 24 verse 18.
Romans chapter 24 verse 18.
Yes.
And Edom shall be a possession.
Yes.
Seir also, his enemies, shall be a possession.
Yes.
While Israel does valiantly.
Amen. Yes. Amen.